Welcome back. Well, this is now the phase of market where once again just the money is pushing large cap stocks. The mid cap index is almost in red, but the bank Nifty is surging. IndusInd Bank and Kotak Mahindra Bank pull out both these stocks intraday. IndusInd was the one where you saw huge delivery buying yesterday, and as soon as it took support at an important level, yesterday's last 30 minute low, that's taken off. That's IndusInd Bank, of course, 1608 on that stock now. Look at that move. And Kotak Mahindra Bank is the other one where that initial downtick has been bought and how. And that stock now in the green. Mitesh Thakkar back with us.
It's just that for the Nifty Bank, look at the contribution from HDFC Bank. Even that one has come out.
And yes, I think it's basically just, the FI money chasing these stocks. Mitesh, what's the trade now? The market gave that dip. It's bounced back. The bank Nifty is having a phenomenal day once again.
So, Anuj, I did mention that I'm looking at 29,000 as the possible target area for Bank Nifty. See, it's just broken into all-time highs, and high which stood for quite some time, which also saw a big price decline. So, getting past and closing above that, there was a very less chance of it coming below that low again immediately. I think that breakout would have taken a lot of effort, and I think having done that, I think follow-through is the more logical kind of conclusion. So, 29,000 remains as the target. For the time being, I have two buy calls. Godrej Consumer is a buy with a stop at 723 for targets of 760, and Container Corporation is a buy with a stop at 506 for targets of 535.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mitesh, for joining us with your 10 a.m. strategies. Prakash, good morning again. What are you trading at 10?
11,342 is achieved. Now, the next logical technical target should seem to be 11,450. I think it's heading there. Should that's a place I'm looking at. I like two stocks. The one is ACL Tech, certainly looking good to me. And ACL Tech can climb to around levels closer to 1,060, stop below 1,015. The move has just started. In the morning, I did mention that IT and Reliance would have to contribute. Second stock that I like is Dr. Reddy. Here too, I feel that it can see a climb to around 2,770. To 2780, stop below 2670. Pharma is helping it out today.
All right. Well, thanks a lot for that. A lot of stocks hitting new highs once again from the large caps. It's Reliance, Axis Bank, Titan, and from the mid caps, names like Havells, etc., looking pretty good. But now we're going to discuss some brokerage reports. CLSA is betting big on a recovery in the housing sector. In fact, Rhythm Desai of Morgan Stanley also just mentioned that the real estate space is a big buy for him. CLSA says the government's affordability housing program is working well and it should drive an eventual improvement by the end of this year. Vinay Saar, the MD and CEO of LIC Housing Finance, joins us now. Mr. Saar, good morning and thanks for joining us. One view on how demand has shaped up so far. And 85% of your customer base, the trend there saw, say, 6 months ago?
Yeah, as you said, there is some revival of the sector. The growth rates are improving. Though current year, right from the start, we have been having growth rates for the retail business around 6-8%. Till Q3 also, it was around the same level. But going ahead, we are expecting good business in Q4. Traditionally, Q4 is a high volume sector. So I see very good growth in Q4. We should end up the year with a growth rate of around 14-15%.
Okay. Good morning, Mr. Saar. Pleasure having you with us. Can you give us more generally a comment on affordable housing itself or even the residential market? You know, we get contrary views. Until now, we've been bombarded with the views that a lot of NBFCs could not raise money in the last couple of quarters, and therefore some of the real estate projects could remain unfinished. There will be pain in the system. And then you get, in the last 2-3 days, a bunch of brokerage reports saying that the residential market has troughed out. What is the truth? Are you seeing more buying of affordable housing or for residents in general?
Affordable housing, if I see for our company, we did about 21,000 loans last year. Current year till February, we have already done about 31,000 loans, which constitutes about 20% of our total sales. Going ahead also, I see, because the government has extended the subsidy availability period till March 2020, going ahead, the demand is there. Affordable is contributing a lot, as I said before. The program, the sales and other things have not taken a hit. The good thing is that enough of inventory also is there, especially in Tier 2, Tier 3 cities. And okay. For us, most of the sales have happened in Tier 2, Tier 3 cities as far as affordable housing goes.
But how is demand, sir? Not just affordable. Generally, home demand.
Generally, home demands, as I said, I had given you the growth numbers. Mm. If we see it, compare it with last year's, we have been experiencing a growth rate of about 7-8%. I would say if all throughout the year, we at no point of time we experienced a very high growth rate as far as the retail sector goes. Only it is in Q4, January, February included, that we have seen some sort of a revival. Some sort of a revival in the demand, and going ahead also, I feel that the demand will pick up and the growth rates should pick up for the sector as a whole, not only for our company, for the sector as a whole.
Okay, we're also getting some news that, you know, the GST committee has proposed that the input tax credit, the benefit that was earlier available to real estate developers, that will lapse and it can't be passed on to the buyers. Will that in any way deter or affect sentiment in the affordable housing space if that comes through?
Passing of input tax credit, it's the responsibility of the developer to give it back, to pass it on to the buyer. We have also got some news that probably
they won't
it'll end on whatever is due will end on 31st of March. Mm. But as it is going ahead, 1st April onwards, because government has reduced the rates, GST tax rates, input credit was not available to the builders. And that's beyond 1st of April. Mm.
But the existing credit also cannot be claimed. And therefore, the fear was that whatever input tax credit they claimed, since they have to pay back, they will pass it on as higher house prices. Is that how developers will behave? And in that case, will home demand be impacted?
No, see, demand impact may or may not be there. But yeah, as you said, it's now on the developers to pass it on to the borrowers. And let us hope that probably going ahead there is a some sort of a rethink on this, and historically what is due should be passed on to the borrowers even beyond 1st of April.
Okay. So this 14-15% growth that you spoke about just a while back, is that what is that? Is that disbursement growth? Because in the quarter gone by, your disbursement growth was just about 4%. If you look at it year on year.
Yeah, no, year on year, in the quarter gone by also, the overall growth rate was about 14%. Only for the housing loan segment, it was about 6%, 4.5%. So going ahead, this 15% is overall growth rate for disbursement. And in addition to that, I may tell you that we are also aiming at more than 16% growth rate in the portfolio. Okay. The whole of the loan book.
AUM has grown by 16%, I take your point. But developer disbursals last time around were quite high at about 28%. And I am told that in your breakup, you have about 22%. I mean, 78% are retail home loans, but 22% are partly developer loans and partly retail LAP. In the developer segment, are you okay with the loan quality? Is there any fear of default?
Yeah, as you said, the growth rate, if you see only the growth rate part, the developer growth rates seem to be quite high, but that is on a low base is number one. Our developer share, as you already said, is currently in the loan book is about 6%. Currently, We are servicing about 240-odd accounts on the developer loan side, out of which, if I have to see the NPAs, the big NPA, I mean, four or five loans constitute the big NPAs. Going ahead, currently we do not see any of the developer loans, big developer loans, medium developer loans going into NPA in the current quarter or maybe in the next 2-3 quarters also.
Okay, all right. We leave it at that, Mr. Sahar. Thanks so much for joining us and telling us exactly how the industry is going to shape up in the months to come. But let's get back to the markets, because for now, the Bank Nifty is doing okay, but the rest of the market is absolutely flat. In fact, the mid-caps have now moved into the red, down almost 0.2%. Manisha Gupta is here with us to tell us what the commodity markets are up to this morning. Hi, Manisha. Good morning.
Morning, Sonia. Thank you. Well, we have seen most of the commodities actually start Asia on a very strong note, starting with the crude oil prices itself. We are trading at a three-week highs, and almost all fundamentals really are supportive. Until now, we've been talking about the OPEC and the allies pledging to cut further as they move into April. More deeper cuts expected out of Saudi Arabia. The one concern has been the U.S. output at record highs and expected to be so for the next 3 or 4 years. But with the latest EIA report, which suggests that the U.S. production will continue at record highs, but the output growth will slow down in 2019. And the maximum that they see in sense of U.S. production is at 12.3 million barrels per day. We already are at 12.1. So that is something that the markets really can live with. And that has been bullish for the prices. Apart from that, it also has been about the API reporting a decline in U.S. crude and gasoline inventories for the previous week. That also seems to be finding its way in prices. And add to that, a slight marginal weakness in the U.S. dollar. That overall has been supportive for most of those commodities today. So not just crude oil prices, but when you look at the precious metal prices, they also seem to be working quite well. In case of gold prices, we are back above $1,300 per ounce in the international markets. We've done 1284 off a low from those kind of levels. It's nearly $20 up as we trade in the global space. 32,000 is back in case of gold, and the silver prices, well, that has actually continued to outperform gold in last 4 or 5 sessions because of the kind of run-up that we've seen in metals as well. The other thing that has been supportive precious metals is the Brexit vote, which has failed yesterday. That seems to be adding to some safe haven buying in that space as well. The base metal prices, well, there's plenty happening for that. The weakness in U.S. dollar has been supportive. There is positive noises on the U.S. and China trade talks. There is a key port shutdown from Vale in Brazil. That's added to price gains in steel and iron ore as well. And then it is about the China stimulus measures, which seem to be finally working its way in much of that economic data. That seems to be very, very supportive. So yet another day when you are looking at further gains in the metal prices. We are at multi-month highs for many metals like copper, nickel, zinc. They are trading at anywhere between 7 to 9 month highs on the LME right now. Trading strategies, and we have them from Angel. It's a buy call continuing for silver. 39,200 is your target, but it's a sell on crude oil prices. 33,920 is the level that they're keeping their eye on today.
All right. Thank you very much for that. There has been a bit of a dip in the global metal prices, and that has had a minor impact, but otherwise crude doing strong. Thank you very much, Manisha. We'll, of course, touch base with you on the hour. For the moment, we have to take a break, but the market's playing actually hide and seek, or zigzag, if you please. We saw this sharp recovery come in Nifty Bank after the initial dip of about 0.5%. We saw a rise of about 0.75% on the Nifty Bank, and that rise also has gotten sold into. So we're again seeing a little bit of a giving up of the gains, still about 0.5% higher. If you pull up the mid-cap chart, you'll again see a fair amount of zigzag with the markets dipping a lot in the initial stages, the dip getting bought, and again, the high also getting sold off. So this is going to be a tricky market today to trade. But what are the larger technicals telling us? Over year to date, if you looked at the markets, we found the Indian markets not participating in the EM rally up until mid-February, and then a huge rally coming in both the mid-cap space, and now, of course, followed by the large caps as well. We're going to track technicals with Biju Samuel from Elara Securities, who has a very interesting report saying that India is perhaps on the verge of a very big breakout.